You know, because I was kind of setting up this seminar series myself, I somehow forgot to ask people to introduce me, right? So I'll just introduce myself. Yeah, I'm Sergey Gavrilets. I'm in ecology, evolutionary biology, and mathematics. I'm also with Nimbus and with DISOC. We actually just had a very nice, very first meeting with DISOC. And what I do are mathematical models. For a long time, it was mostly models in biological systems and evolutionary systems. But over the last 10 years, I've been kind of moving towards models of social evolution and social complexity. So this is what I want to do. I give you some background information first, and when I talk about general modeling framework, yeah, I do models, I know, if I didn't mention that. And it will be a kind of a framework with relatively simple models. And then I give you four different examples of how these models can be have been used to advance understanding of some pretty complex social processes. Okay, so I want to start with pretty far away in the back, right? So this is evolutionary tree of primates. Primates originated when dinosaurs went extinct, right? And this is something that was happening over the last 20 million years. We separated from chimpanzees. About 6 or 7 million years ago. And we have a lot of information about what's going on during this several last million years. There has been a lot of different species, presumably species of our relatives. As recently as 30,000 years ago, there were 3 or maybe 4 different species inhabiting our planet. And many different things were happening, and very exciting things were happening, very puzzling things were happening during this time. I'm going to show you just one picture, and it shows the increase in brain size and presumably intelligence over the last 3.5 million years in our lineage. So you see there was a big step here about 1.8 million years ago, and then about 500,000 years ago, a process started that looks like exponential increase in brain size and in intelligence. And when you think about these processes, there is a number of fundamental questions that come up. What makes us the uniquely unique species and how we came to be? And for evolutionary biologists, the question how we came to be is basically the question about selective forces and selective constraints. So it's about past, but there are also very important questions about present. What are the implications of our ancestral past for modern humans, for our behavior? And how can we understand and predict our social behavior? And these are questions that are becoming more and more important in the last few decades. I have a quote here from a poem that is almost 400 years old, a famous poem. No man is an island entire of itself. Each is a piece of the continent, a part of the main. So I think these words that were said first 400 years ago, they are becoming more and more true right now with the increase in communications and connections in the world. And if we really want to understand what's happening here right now, and if we want to improve it, or at least not to make it worse, we really need to understand how people behave, how social institutions are developed, how we build them, and all these different things and factors that I would outline very briefly. I will outline later in my talk. So, and if we want to really do that, we need to use new approaches to doing science. And the keyword is transdisciplinarity. So the questions that we are looking at are so complex that researchers from one particular discipline or from one particular research area cannot really advance much. We do need inputs from many different disciplines. And as far as humans and human social behavior is concerned, it's biologists, it's anthropologists, psychologists, political scientists, economists, historians, philosophers, all these people, as well as modelers, the people who do mathematical models and use computational methods. Okay, so now going back to the questions I started with. About our distinctiveness or our uniqueness. So what makes us different? Well, different people, different researchers give different answers to this question, and they emphasize rather different things. So I have some of them here. It's cooperation, it's cognitive abilities, language, culture, learning, social institutions, and social norms. What I think emerging consensus in this field is actually that it's cooperation that is probably the most important thing. And all our things, they also emerged and they developed to simplify cooperation. And cooperation can be classified into two different types. It's cooperation to solve different challenges that our environment puts forward to us, and also challenges that emerge from competition between different groups. Of course, cooperation is not something that is uniquely human. There are multiple examples of cooperation in very simple organisms, like, well, insects, for example, very simple, but their behavior is very far from simple. They build bridges, they build temples. And of course, cooperation is crucial also in defense, in hunting, and in attacks. These are chimpanzees that go on border patrol. They go on a patrol, and if they encounter isolated individuals from a neighboring group, they will likely attack and may kill them. So cooperation happens in animals as well, not just humans. But in humans, it's completely different as far as its scale is concerned. And cooperation is in very simple societies, hunter-gatherers. That's how our ancestors, the state that our ancestors used to be for hundreds of thousands of years, presumably. But also as the first civilizations emerged, it was becoming bigger and bigger in scale, right? And it concerns, again, nature challenges, but also cooperation against other groups, right? I have several images of warfare here. Right, and we have International Space Station, enormous project. We have pyramids, and we have all these skyscrapers that Chinese companies now are able to build like in a few weeks of enormous size. So humans are indeed unique as far as the extent of cooperation is concerned. But if you look at the origin of these abilities, it basically goes back to the fact that we live in groups, right? And group living is widespread in animals. And when you live in groups, you share costs, you share benefits, and you are expected to develop specific adaptations to deal with social environment. When you live together, you have to do certain things together. You have to coordinate, for example, where you hunt or where you sleep, but also you have to actively collaborate. And it was, as already mentioned, very important for our ancestors. For hundreds of thousands of years of our hunter-gatherers who passed cooperation in hunting, in defense, in conflicts, was extremely important. In humans, cooperation can be, if it's done right, can be enormously profitable because of the economy of scale. People, if they join their effort, can produce much more good stuff for them than if they do it individually. But to do that, there are certain challenges that we have to overcome. We have to be able to effectively coordinate actions, we have to be able to resolve conflicts, and also to minimize free riding. Right, so free riding is something that is extremely widespread. The fact that individuals living in a group share costs and benefits don't mean that there are no conflicts between them. Conflict of interest is always present, and it's well established in economics literature that it results in certain things like defection in the prisoner's dilemma, or over-exploitation of collective goods, or withdrawal of effort in production of public goods. So this is something that comes under the general rubric of collective action problem, right? That's the notion that Mansur Olson introduced in his PhD work almost or 60 years ago, right? So if you have a group of people trying to do something, and if they will be sharing the benefit produced, there is always a motivation to reduce your effort or withdraw it completely, because it's costly, right? But if everybody follows this logic, the goods are not produced and everybody suffers, right? So I have here several examples. This is quite interesting example. Anybody knows what is this? We call it beer bus, right? And it's, I took this picture in Madrid. So basically people are having a party, we're drinking beer, right? And we pedal. And somehow this thing moves, and it moves very rapidly. So people are able to overcome collective action problem, right? And that's very strange. And why we do that? Well, the effort here is costly, right? Your physical effort. But so there are some material costs involved. But when we make decisions, when we decide if we're going to do this thing or that thing, it's not just about material cost and benefits, right? It's material cost and benefits are important, but it's not the whole thing, right? We also have certain instincts that have developed in our ancestors over hundreds of thousands of or maybe millions of years. We also learn where there are certain events that we interpret one way or another in the past, of our group, for example, or our family. We also make errors, do certain things just by mistake. Plus, there are social norms and social institutions that affect our behavior. So all these things are extremely important as far as human social behavior is concerned. So that's basically what we really need to understand and kind of in, to understand better what's happening with us and with our societies. And there has been a lot of effort in this direction, right? Well, I already mentioned Olson's book, like 60 years old, Prisoner's Dilemma. It came up like in the 40s or 50s during the Cold War. So there has been a lot of effort done mostly in economics. But in spite of all this effort, there are also big gaps. So there is a number of things that are not usually considered in this work. For example, heterogeneity, differences between individuals, also the fact that there are other things besides material payoffs. There are different biological factors, right? For example, genetic relatedness or migration or possibility of extinction. There are certain assumptions about the way how individuals make their pick the right strategy and things like that. So, and that's the gaps are important, and that's what we are trying to understand better, to fill or remove and improve these methods. So, in my own research, kind of when I look at that, I use a combination of different approaches. I use more classical game theoretic models, but also borrow a lot from evolutionary models, also stuff from physics. You have to do agent-based simulations, because once a model becomes a little bit more interesting and more important and more complex, you lose ability to find solutions analytically. So you have to do simulations. Sometimes, yeah, you want to check the predictions of your models, right? And you are forced to look for data. Experimental economics approaches become important. And also a lot of stuff already exists in different databases that you need to find. So typical research strategy here is you start with simple models, analytical models. When you make them more complex, you try to do simulations, and then you test your models against data and see what happens. Okay, So that's kind of the general overview of the approach. And now I'll move into some modeling details, how I do it and how our people do it. And I'll try to keep this description very simple, very basic. So basically, we look at populations that live in, of individuals who live in groups, right? And individuals make certain efforts. For example, they collaborate or whatever. They're also different, and they can differ in a number of different factors. They have different motivations. It can be material benefits. It can be some beliefs, some norms, or some learning. And these groups, they may compete against our groups. And there are certain encounter different obstacles that I already mentioned. So the questions what we want to see is how and when cooperation works, right? And how we can promote collective action, or under some conditions, how we can suppress collective action, depending on the context. So how we do it in mathematical models? Well, there will be individuals, and individuals will be making certain efforts. For example, it can be like effort in a collective action X, all right? Or it can be something else. It can be monitoring or punishment or norm promotion, whatever. So we can have different variables for that. Okay? So we have individuals, but individuals live in groups. So we have to aggregate individual efforts into a group effort. In the simple case, we just sum up individual efforts, right? That will be our impact function, right? Or it can be something more complex, like best shot or weak link or something with synergicity. Okay? So now individuals make an effort. Okay? And the question is what we make effort for, what we are trying to achieve. Well, as I already mentioned, there are, I think, two general types of collective actions that were important for our ancestors and they still exist now. And I call them us versus nature and us versus them games. So in one case, well, examples from Pleistocene will be something like defense from predators or hunting, whatever. And us versus them is direct competition with our groups. So I will define the probability of success. It will be my capital P, like this in these 2D games. And in both cases, it increases with effort. The more effort your group makes, the higher is the probability that it is successful in securing some reward, some resource from nature or from other groups. I want to emphasize that here we're dealing with a volunteer's dilemma, not a prisoner's dilemma, right? That's an important thing, because for many people, when they think about cooperation in evolutionary biology, we immediately start thinking about prisoner's dilemma and Martin Novak. So that's not what it is. Okay, so it's a volunteer's dilemma. And we do well volunteer, right? So I have here different pictures, right? Examples of volunteering. I believe this person here is Vladimir Lenin. I don't know if you know the name, but it's like one of the first subotniks in the Soviet Russia. All right. So in these examples, people volunteer their time and a little bit of their effort. But sometimes they volunteer for something that is extremely dangerous, right? They go to war. And it's starting with Spanish War and, well, many different wars, including some quite recent. Okay, so that will be us versus them, examples of us versus them games. So now we have individuals, they make efforts, there are groups, and groups achieve certain success, right? And then we have to specify material payoffs, right? So that will be pi, so this is your baseline level, this is the overall benefit that you can get. P, remember, is the probability of success. These are individual costs. And then I have here V, it will be the share of the reward or valuation, how much individuals value this resource, right? So that's the basic model that describes material payoffs, right? And I want to emphasize that here we can capture different types of heterogeneity. Individuals can differ in baseline resource, in cost coefficients, or in valuation, how much they value or how much they get. Okay. In the models, we also allow for group extinction. A very simple way to do that is just say that the group survives with probability proportional to its success in a collective action, like which makes sense. Okay. But material payoffs, as already said, is not everything, right? People are driven often by other things, right? by some values, right? So in this case, we can, instead of payoffs, we can look at the generalization, look at some utility function, and it will have two components. It will be material payoff, and there will be some immaterial value, the value that you assigned. And also I have a coefficient, eta, that gives the weight of, if eta is zero, we basically just maximizing material payoff. If it is one, we don't care about material payoff, only about normative value, right? And this will be a measure of strength internalization. Okay, so now we have efforts, individual group efforts, we have probability of success, we have material payoffs, and then we have utility, right? And then the next thing is to describe how actually individuals make decisions, how we choose one action or another one. Right, and it comes under the rubric of strategy revision protocol in evolutionary game theory. There is a number of different things that I already mentioned. Right, it can be some kind of optimization, it can be learning, it can be random innovation, it can be conformity. We also developed with Logan. Where is Logan? Yeah, here a new approach for. Choosing strategy that includes ability of foresight. So there is the whole set of different things that are important and that we are trying to include into models. Okay, so that's now a general mathematical framework. Groups, individual effort, groups effort, probability of success, costs, how we divide the reward, material payoffs, immaterial benefits, values, or their beliefs, and when how actual decisions are made. So next, I'll switch now to four different examples that I want to present you and show how it works. Okay, so the first one is very basic, just looking at a collective action in heterogeneous groups. And this is a project that I did with Laura Fortunata from Oxford a few years ago. So basically, as I already said, we are looking at just heterogeneous groups and trying to understand how they will behave in a situation where the group is facing some kind of a challenge, us versus nature or us versus them. So heterogeneity is important, but it's typically disregarded in existing models. So I'm not going to show you analytical results where they exist. I will just show you some numerical illustrations, and I will talk a bit about interpretations of this. So the first, okay, let me explain first what you see here. So here are examples of individual contributions in a collective action, right? Each color corresponds to individual, to particular individual, and individuals differ in their dominance or in the share of the reward that we are getting. You can think of these red individuals as alpha individuals. We are getting the biggest share of the reward. Blue will be beta, gamma, and so on. So in this example, there are four individuals. Here, there are eight individuals. So color gives the dominance of the share of the reward. There are different columns here, and they correspond to different heterogeneity, to different degree of inequality within the group. On the left side, you have equal groups, egalitarian groups. On the right side, you have the highest inequality in the group. So the total bar gives the total group effort. So individual segments are individual efforts. Total is the total group effort. B here is the benefit, right? And naturally, as you increase the benefit, effort is increasing. But what I also want to show you are several things. The red bar has the highest length. So these are dominant individuals, individuals who are getting the biggest share of the reward. And as you can see, they are making the biggest effort. So that comes in economics literature under the rubric of exploitation of the great by the small. Individuals who are getting the biggest share of the reward, they make the most effort. Everybody else, we are free riding. We are exploiting, in a sense, dominant individuals. All right, so that's one thing. Inequality. In the examples that I show you, remember, inequality increases as you go from the left to the right. The total bar grows with inequality. So here, the conclusion is that in unequal groups, they are more efficient in between group conflict. But I want to emphasize that it depends on parameters, right? It depends on certain on the way costs are structured. Under some other conditions, egalitarian groups will do better than hierarchical groups. Okay. Well, now I think what is not apparent here, but it's a rather general prediction, a rather general result, is that us versus nature, us versus them games are much more conducive than us versus nature games. So cooperation is the easiest to evolve if there is some kind of a conflict between groups. There is warfare. That's a pretty much general result. Okay, and of course, and group extinction simplifies that. And then there is a very interesting effect that I call altruistic bully effect, and Laura didn't like that term at all. So look, so this left side shows the efforts, but the right side shows the share of the benefit, net payoff to individuals. All right? And what you can see is that individuals who make the biggest effort, these dominant individuals, dominant group members, bullies, they end up with the small, under some conditions, they end up with the smallest share of the reward. So effectively, they behave as altruists for their groups. Everybody else is free riding, right? So if you look at the within group dynamics, dominant individuals are bad guys because they grab the biggest share of the product. They get, I don't know, like if you're thinking about chimpanzees, they get the biggest share of the meat, they get the best sleeping places, they have a lot of mating opportunities. But if there is between group conflict involved, then they become good guys. Because basically we're securing the biggest share of the reward, we're making the biggest effort. Under some conditions, actually, their net payoff can go to zero. And I'll talk about that in a few minutes. They will effectively sacrifice themselves for the benefit of the group. Okay, so these are theoretical predictions. And when we start looking at the literature, biological literature, and what happens. Well, there is a number of species where collective action is indeed present. And all these species actually is almost it's very difficult for different biological organisms to overcome it. One of the predictions was with exploitation of the great by the small. And there is indeed a number of species in primates where dominant individuals will make the biggest effort as far as between group conflicts are concerned. So these are non-human animals. But similar things exist in humans, as psychological research shows. We indeed are very much affected by any real or perceived conflict with another group. So there is this predisposition. Just mentioning that there is some kind of conflict automatically changes our behavior. There are in-group and out-group biases, also something that is well-known. And also, there is experimental work that shows that highly competitive and sometimes arrogant individuals that are kind of bad guys from the point of view of within group dynamics or high-status individuals, they make unproportionately higher effort if between group conflicts are involved. So there are data that the model explains pretty well. Okay, so that was the first example. Okay, so the second one is in our project done with somebody from Oxford University, Harvey Whitehouse. So he's a psychologist who's been studying extreme self-sacrifice. And what we know from historical records and also from what we read in social media and newspapers is that people are often willing to lay down their life for the sake of what they perceive as their group, right? And to understand why they do that from evolutionary point of view, it's a big puzzle, right? Because basically, yeah, you give your life away. There is no evidence that this type of behavior is is pathological, but at the same time, there is a lot of data that suggests that this type of behavior can be linked to something that psychologists call identity fusion. Right? As Bill Swan from Texas is the person who kind of started with this field of research. So identity fusion is a kind of alignment with groups in which members really think themselves to be a part of it. Right? How psychologists do that? Well, we use very simple vignettes. We just show you things like outline here, say this is you, this is your group, tell us where you think, how merged you are with your groups, right? Or you can do similar things by asking people to answer certain questions. And then it gives you the measure of identity fusion. Okay? And it turns out, and this is a result of a lot of recent work done by over 10 years or so, is that the cause of a common cause of identity fusion is shared experience. And usually it's a very bad experience. It's dysphoric, it's very negative experience. And you can think of some events, like bombing events, or war, or whatever, or you can think of some rituals, right? It can be religious rituals, or it can be like fraternities, or whatever. But these are things that bond people together. So when Harvey first told me about that, he also described certain explanations. Typically, it's kind of a typical explanation is that we people somehow misinterpret. Well, basically, it's kind of kin relationship, but misinterpreted. We start viewing group members as brothers in some sense. But that didn't kind of his explanation didn't really make sense to me, and the idea that came up quite quickly was that probably it's some kind of adaptation that evolved in our ancestors in the past, because for all these hundreds of thousands of years, humans, we lived in small groups and we experienced different events, and survival was not easy at all. Okay? So the idea was to build a mathematical model to try to see if this indeed can work. Right, so a model that would include group extinction, individual efforts, and things like that. So in mathematical terms, basically it would be a model of cooperation, but cooperation conditioned on something that happened to your group, something that you share with your group. Okay, so because it's conditioned, like I will simplify things, I will postulate that there are groups, and we encounter different types of events, good events and bad events, dysphoric or euphoric events. And I will also postulate that there is some psychological mechanism that kind of turns on one type of behavior or another one. Okay? So that makes me to look at a model where there will be two types of efforts. Again, it will be individuals will be making efforts, groups will be making efforts, there will be individual payoffs, right? But different types of efforts will be turned on depending on the environment. Plus, this euphoric or dysphoric event will affect group survival. Group that have encountered bad event, we will have smaller probability of survival than groups that enjoyed good life, in a sense, right? So you see, I have in the probability of group survival, I have zero here, but it will be H over there. So groups with euphoric experience, with good experience, we will have higher, given everything else is the same, we will have higher probability of surviving. So that's basically the main difference here. Again, now we have a model, all right, and we explore it, and we find analytical results, right? We find numerical illustrations, so this graph is to show effects of different parameters on with X and Y on the efforts, but I'm not going to go into this. I'll just go to predictions and interpretation of this model. And the model, very simple, actually produced a lot, a number of interesting predictions. First, it does show that individual behavior will be, will evolve behavior that will be conditioned on the previous events. The model shows that dysphoric and the groups that dysphoric experience would cause higher efforts in collective action than euphoric one. A stronger experience will produce stronger effects. Us against them will be much more conducive for evolution of this type of behavior than us versus nature. The effect is strongest in small groups. And also, under some conditions, this shared experience, that's what the model predicts, will be more important than shared genes. So individuals who shared experience will be more willing to sacrifice themselves when they send twin brothers. Okay. And finally, the model shows that under some conditions, individuals who are highly fused with their group, they will sacrifice themselves. So they basically, going back to the model that I started with, they will be with altruistic bullies, in a sense, who will end up with zero payoff, with zero fitness. So model shows, makes all these predictions. So as I said, I started this as a project with Harvey. And I was going kind of to quickly write a paper because the stuff was pretty cool. But he wanted to test these predictions. Okay, so I had to wait another year and a half for him to do that. So he recruited a bunch of collaborators and then ran, I think, a set of eight different sets of experiments that focus on five specific hypotheses emerging from this work. First about this effect of shared experience, when dysphoric versus euphoric intensity of this experience. He also compared us versus nation, us versus them situation, and managed to get data on twins and see how shared experience fares against shared genes. And you can see there is a whole set of different groups, natural disaster, terrorist attack, people who experienced that, English Premier League, veterans from Vietnam, fraternities, sororities, Brazilian jiu-jitsu, and things like that. And pretty much the results fit well quite well with our predictions. Just let me illustrate one particular set of data. It was done with soccer fans in English Premier League. So in this league, there are teams that usually do pretty well, right? And there are like four or five of them. And there are those that are always suck, right? And what we've done, we recruited supporters of different teams, and we ran them through different tests. And what the results show that basically supporters of it, Damien, is your team here?
My team's Manchester United.
Okay, maybe you'll unite as a result of it. But basically, what all these data show that yes, indeed, supporters of team that always kind of losing, we are much closer together. We are much more willing to do things for the benefit of their group, for their fan club, or just their club. And our results, our experiments will also fit predictions pretty well. Okay, that was example number two. The third one is about social norms, right? And it's a project, joint project with Pete Richardson, we've actually been collaborating on a lot of things lately. So it's about social norms. Our life is basically constrained a lot by social norms. And there are all different types of social norms. I don't know, for example, how you dress, right? How you position yourself once you enter the elevator, and differs between different countries. If you jaywalk or not, right? So here, across the library, we changed traffic lights. So now people just go without looking at what's going on. Apparently, the light is not visible. It's only from one side, not from the other. So social norm changed very quickly. So there are different types of norms. But some norms are internalized, right? And this is a very interesting psychological process. So basically, you accept the norm to the extent that you believe that this is the right thing to do, all right? And you don't care much about I mean, the cost or benefits. And people who internalize norms, they experience two different effects. First, yeah, they just follow it. And another one is that they criticize or disapprove people who don't do that. Okay. So the question is how this ability to internalize norms evolved and what would be the consequences of that. Okay. Again, I'm taking my general framework of collective action, but now on top of a contribution to collective public goods, I also allow for possibility to punish free riders. Okay. And when I say that individuals are motivated not just by material payoffs, but there is some kind of utility that has a value, normative value, right? So there will be individuals who, if there are individuals who don't care about norm at all, they will be described by E to zero, but also there will be individuals who believe that the right thing to do is, well, the right thing to do, and they don't care about material benefits. So what I want to see, is it possible for this ETA to evolve from zero to some values where it will become important in groups? Okay. So now the model gets a bit more complicated because it operates on two different time scales. On one, there is fast time scale where individuals make decisions, but there will be also slow time scale where this ETA will evolve. And if we analyze this model, we see some interesting things happening. So here are different types of individuals. So at some point, individuals who didn't do anything, who were free riding, pretty much disappear, and cooperation gets established. Okay. As a result of this, overall payoffs increase. But what happens is very interesting as far as the degree of internalization is concerned. Just here, this is time, and there are individuals who have different values of this parameter eta, right? And if there is an individual with a particular value, I put a black pixel here. So basically, if you look across vertical line, it gives you the distribution of this trait in the whole group. And what you can see here are rather interesting things about this time moment. The group splits into two clusters. This is one cluster with eta equal to zero, and this is another cluster with eta equal to one, to high value. The red line gives the average, but average doesn't matter here because individuals either internalize norms or don't. So there is this genetic differentiation in groups. The claim is that humans have, and it's been supported by some data, that humans have a genetic predisposition for this ability to internalize or not the social norms. So the graphs that I show here are quite, well, this behavior is quite generic. Okay, so now when we look at this model, again, we end up with certain conclusions. It shows that basically, yeah, norm internalization evolves. And it evolves because it is a way for both individuals and for groups to increase their payoffs and their fitness. It's kind of unavoidable. And this can happen in both types of games. And what I said was very interesting, that there is this split, genetic split in individuals. So in a sense, the model predicts that the population as a whole will have certain proportion of individuals who will do whatever it takes if they believe in it. Right, and at the same time, there will be a large group of individuals who will not do that. There is another interesting conclusion somewhere here. It's about the effect of punishment. So basically, societies that promote punishment, where elders tell youngsters, if you see something wrong, you have to punish individual doing wrong. So these societies are much more successful than societies where it's the emphasis is not on punishment, but on contribution to a collective action. Okay, and then there are some other conclusions that you can see here. Okay, I have 5 minutes left, right? Okay, so and now this is the last example, right? And this is an example concerning with evolution of institutions, power and inequality, right? So inequality is a hot topic, right? And it's been a very important topic for many, many years. And here are some graphs, right? And it's from a famous Piketty book that came out several years ago. And I'm sure you've seen these graphs multiple times for example, yeah, these are graphs illustrating the extent of inequality and dynamics of inequality in this country. So it's been steadily growing since 1970. Okay, and the similar things were happening also in English-speaking countries, right? Britain, Canada, Australia. Interesting, in some countries it did not happen, right? So there is this growth in inequality over the last couple of generations, and it's something that concerns people a lot. And it's not the process that is unique for our time. There is another great book by Walter, came out just a few months ago, so he's a historian, right, studying economics. So he looked at trends in inequality across different countries. This is Europe, and this is over the last, I don't know, 2,000 years. This is in the States over the last 400 years. This is Latin America. So there are all these dynamics where inequality usually grows, but occasionally comes down. And what Walter did, he looked at all these processes, right, over the last few thousand years. And his conclusion was that inequality always increases. There are only few cases where it goes down. And these cases is when something bad happens, right? And he talks about four horsemen of leveling. It's some kind of huge war, it's a revolution, it's state collapse, or it's some kind of infection that spreads. And these events are the only events that reduce inequality, and they reduce inequality, but basically the wealth from wealthy individuals is taken or removed. Okay? So his conclusion that that's where it happens, right? How it happens. And then there is the next question. Is actually inequality, the growth inequality itself leads to these things or not, right? And Branko Milanović, again, there is another great, great book. Basically, yeah, his conclusion is yes. Rising inequality sets in motion certain forces of destructive nature, right? And they will destroy not only inequality, but a lot of millions of lives and huge amount of wealth. All right, so that's kind of, again, very interesting situation and amenable to mathematical modeling, right? So now I'm looking at a model, and again, it's kind of the model that I've been looking so far at, right? The model of collective action. The main difference here, remember this V, it was like the share of the reward, right? I will interpret it as a measure of power. The bigger your power, the bigger the share of the reward is, okay? And then on top of that, I add an equation, very simple equation. It basically goes back to what is known in evolutionary biology as a replicator equation, where it describes how power changes. Yeah. No, in this case, it's just individuals will just they just take. It's not transferred from one. If you mean it's not transferred from one time step, it's a very simple model. Yeah. Okay, so that's basically the model, right? Yeah, just very simple generalization. And if you do it, and again, I have analytical results, but there are also numerical results. This is what you see. Let me show you. Yeah, this is the power of different factions. And you see power of one goes up, others go down, right? And these are the resources that we have. The most powerful faction in the society grabs the biggest of the resource. And when inequality grows, this black line is a Gini index, is a standard measure for measuring inequality. And when inequality grows, and then the whole society collapses. Yeah, here is the black means where the particular faction cooperates. White is that it moves into opposition to the government, right? So what this shows is that there is continuous growth in inequality that results in a complete collapse of cooperation in this model. And then this collapse resets the level of power between different factions, and then the process repeats itself. This is in different illustration, but the dynamics are pretty much the same. So I want to emphasize that this model focuses on the dynamics of cooperation. right? And what happens here at the end is the collapse of cooperation. The next question is indeed, will this collapse of cooperation result in the collapse of society, right? So that's something that is outside of the model, right? But you can think of these things. Okay, well, I think that's all. Thank you very much. Yeah, Chris, would you? Gary first, yeah.
Okay, yeah, I have two questions, but I'll just choose one. It seems like your first project and your last project are really connected, right? So you start with this altruistic bully that sacrifices the most when it comes to group conflict. But it also seems like they lose the most given your last set of findings, right? That inequality truncates. Yeah. So do you tie those two together somehow?
Well, I think even in the second project, it's also linked, right? Because individuals who are sacrificing themselves, they value the group success the most.
Right. But they're not quite as altruistic as...
No, if they give their life, right? If and I don't know, blow themselves up or volunteer and go to war.
Right. I guess they're thinking they'll face the guillotine either way.
Well, they fuse with their group.
Yeah. Okay, and quick question for the second one. When you talk about collective action, you're really modeling the decision to undertake collective action and whether it's worthwhile depending on a variety of parameters. What about the ability to take collective action, right? So, all of us in this group may decide that it's worthwhile for us to play soccer together, but we get in the field and we fall all over ourselves.
Yeah, well, that comes into this heterogeneity thing. So I allow for individuals to be different. They can differ in the way they value the reward or in the cost that they pay or in their ability. Yeah, so that's kind of captured in the model. Yeah. Yeah, well, that's actually a great question, and to look at that would be very interesting. So basically, and there is a lot of controversy in this field, as some of you know, about the role of warfare and the role of conflict. Some people, including my close friends and collaborators, they claim that warfare was extremely important for us, but many anthropologists, they refuse to accept it. Some say that war became important only in the last 10,000 years. So in this case, you would not see similar triggers or similar type of psychology. Yeah, that's something pretty cool thing to do. Yeah.
I just want to try and understand a bit better. So for example, the model that you had looking at the euphoric versus dysphoric events and how that influences things. With the football teams as an example, right? I didn't quite get how the selective pressures actually influence whether or not, you know, the response to euphoric and dysphoric events. So like if I think about those two, those examples, mm-hmm. if there's a losing football team mm-hmm. and they're willing to, you know, they're losing all the time, so they get really sad. And so they start helping out their friends or they're willing to like lay down their mm-hmm. lives. That's not going to help the football team actually win. So okay. so, mm-hmm. so what's the link there? Do you mm-hmm. see what I'm asking?
Well, in the model, basically the group survival, given everything is the same, survival of groups with euphoric experience was higher than those with dysphoric. And let me give you an example. You mentioned the teams. So there are actually data that show like NBA, in NBA, if there is a team that is losing by a couple of points before halftime, it will more likely win the game. So in a sense, that would be like first halftime, you can view it as a dysphoric experience for these groups, and when they overcome.
So your model actually includes a positive influence of dysphoric events on
outcomes. Well, it's
outcomes.
Not positive, it's negative. But basically, if you lost the first game, the only way for you to survive is to double your efforts, in a sense.
Okay.
So that's how I explain it intuitively.
Okay.
If life is good, there is basically you are less motivated to work hard.
One of the things that you haven't talked much about was development. How individuals develop in a society, which may be very important in the directions that they take and in the levels of inequality and cooperation and a variety of these things. You mentioned the work done with infants showing that many of them have this Paul Bloom's work and mm-hmm. so on. They could sort of tell good and bad and mm-hmm. Very early on. But how would you put into your model then the developmental mm-hmm. processes mm-hmm. and how societies may mm-hmm. differ in how they implement and do that. Mm-hmm. You know, Plato was very, of course, in mm-hmm. the Republic mm-hmm. very much involved mm-hmm. with that.
Well, there are several things. First, kind of, I didn't talk about that, but there is this, one of the strategy revision protocols is learning, where you learn from our individuals, right? So basically, there is a lot of models where this is included. But at the same time, I did have these social norms and values. So in a sense, the third model, we had like the situation that I would imagine that you have very like small scale society, and there are elders, right, that tell youngsters that you have to do good things. Probably elders are thinking about how to make their own life better, right, by teaching the kids. But basically it's there. Depending on the environment, depending on the value, normative value that society puts on certain actions, individuals will develop or not the ability to do these things. So it's, in a sense, in model number three, it's already there. You have to keep track, so we don't.
Yeah. So why do you pick the volunteer's dilemma? Why not, say, the stag hunt? Where free riding has a much smaller, if any, role?
Well, because I wanted to have, so most of the game theoretic literature focuses on games with just two players, right? So I was looking at games with multiple individuals because that's...
You can run the stag hunt with multiple.
Well, but you'll end up pretty much with the same thing, I believe.
Does it?
Yeah. Well, yeah, the goal is to explain certain observable phenomena and then make predictions. Yeah, that's the overall goal, yeah.
When I was, you know, listening to you, I'm thinking about Dostoevsky, for example. That's widely recognized Russian writer. All his heroes and all his novels, in a sense, you know, it's proof that humans are not predictable, especially in the novels from underground. And, you know, though his heroes denied both, as you
You must be a sociologist.
The material table.
Yeah, yeah.
And non-material as well, social. And so his hero said, no, I don't follow that, I don't follow that. And what is interesting is that his heroes could be from high society, from the bottom, doesn't matter. One could say, okay, this is just a writer, a Russian writer, it's about novel, it's about fiction, it's not about reality. Example of, you know, US 2 years ago presidential elections. Most of predictions were not realized. Also, based on most of predictions, based on political analysis, public opinion, polling, social economic analysis, predicted Hillary Clinton. And after the results, the real result, you know, scientists start thinking, the thinking, some sort of, yeah, the problem is without data. Public opinion data was not correct because there was a silent majority of interest won correctly during this so anyway, my question is how you think we could include in modeling of social behavior the factor of unpredictability to be moderated?
Well, I think there are two aspects in your question. One is, yeah, indeed, all individuals are different, right? And when you write a novel, yeah, you don't want to write about somebody kind of average and boring, right? You want to write about something unusual. But the approach, and I think it's a typical approach in science, yeah, you are trying to predict the average behavior, right? And when you have Karamazov three brothers, right? But when you look at 3 million of people, well, you can come up with certain better predictions. And the other thing is, yeah, models indeed, you mentioned that models that are in existence are not perfect at all and when fail. But basically, that's kind of the pitch that I've been making here, that we need better models. And of course, we also need better data and big data. Although, yeah, I know you're not a big fan of big data, but yeah, that's the way you do. Yeah, so probably just one,
Your last model was really depressing given the increasing inequality in our own society. However, I would say that it seems to me that inequality does not inevitably lead to collapse, although that was a conclusion of your model, because you can have a transformation brought about by other things. For example, the end of the Gilded Age saw progressive income tax. It was conflict, but rise of labor unions as a way of bringing inequality down. So that would be something I'm sure you've considered this for future, and a more optimistic view of the future in my...
Yeah, so as you said, and I said, the model was very simple, right? Individual factions are just trying to grab as much power as they can. But of course, in many situations, the elites, if they are smart, they will not try to do it. They will give something to the masses. And this is well-known thing in biology, dominant individuals, they allow for some reproduction to subordinate individuals, otherwise they would live. So that's something that has not been included into the models. Yeah, but it could work.
So I have a slightly different question. So this model you're developing, aspects of this model could be applied to describe or predict behavior of microbial communities. Has this ever been attempted? Have you experienced applying this particular model to describe behavior of microbial communities?
There is a number of models looking at cooperation in microbial organisms. Lucas, I have a student, Lucas here, who wants to work on things like that. Yeah, so, but it's, biology is simple. Right, my microbiology is simple because, but it has been done and more indeed can be done. I think let's give Paul the last question.
I was going to say that was the last one, but
but Paul had his hand Paul like for 10 minutes. Yeah.
So Sergey, sorry, the last model went past fast. And you are trying clearly, and I commit it, to generalize across many ways cooperation may manifest itself. I'm trying to ask you about one specific one and how compatible it is with that last model, because I didn't get enough details down to pin it down, which is where the acceptance of property rights is the model of social cooperation, that we agree we sign up to property rights because they allow us to allocate resources efficiently. Now, the reason I'm interested in that one is that it seems to me that the leveling you're talking about in that instance would be one-to-one maps, anonymous, with the decline of cooperation. So if we cease to cooperate in that we cease to accept property rights, we immediately level the playing field. What wasn't clear to me is whether that needs another layer on the model or whether it's actually fully embedded in what you already have represented.
Because of my kind of background and the work I've done, whenever I start talking about economics and stuff like that, I find myself quickly on very shaky grounds. So I'm much better kind of familiar with biological, and now I believe kind of more with kind of some psychological angles. So about property rights, I don't know much. I'm not sure how I would feed that. I know that some people have been working on this, like Sam Bowles, for example, a well-known economist who's also at Santa Fe. They've had some models of coevolution of property rights and cooperation, and they also link it to the emergence of agriculture. But unfortunately, it's not the area I know much. Sorry.
Would property territoriality in animals, though, be an equivalent to property rights in the defense of territory?
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, let's be the last question. Can we give Sergey a big hand for a very interesting talk?